Talk about The King and I, which was a musical written in 1951 by Rodgers and Hammerstein. They were coming off a slew of hits. They had Oklahoma in 1941, they had Carousel in 1943, and in 1948 they had South Pacific, and now 3 years after that they have The King and I, which proved to be an enormous hit. It was based on a novel that was written in the 1940s by a woman named Margaret Landon. It's based on the autobiography, more or less true, of Anna Leon Owens, who was a Welsh woman, who was a school teacher, who went to Siam to teach the king's children and wives. It was a very popular novel. Only a few years after that, it was made into a film with Rex Harrison and Irene Dunne. And it wasn't many years after that before Gertrude Lawrence got the idea that she would like to star in a musical based upon this book, this film. So she went to see Rodgers and Hammerstein. Now, Rodgers and Hammerstein, as I said, were really at the peak of their powers. They had written several shows together. They had their own way of working. Hammerstein wrote all of the lyrics and the book, the libretto, first, and then Rodgers set the words, the lyrics to music. These were very serious shows. These were adult shows. They concerned themselves with adult problems. They were beautifully constructed. They were serious, even though they had their light moments. Rodgers and Hammerstein were so successful that they formed their own company of both producing and publishing. It was called Williamson. Why was it called Williamson? Because both Richard Rodgers' father was named William, and Oscar Hammerstein II's father was named William. So there they were, the two sons of Williams, and they became Williamson Music Inc. And they produced their own shows. They even produced other people's shows. For example, they commissioned Irving Berlin to write Ain't He Get Your Gun. They were hugely successful. They were quite self-sufficient. And when Gertrude Lawrence went to see them about turning Anna and the King of Siam into a musical, once they agreed, it was a done deal. Nothing was going to stop them. She was already in her 50s. This was 1951, and she was born in 1898. Gertrude Lawrence was certainly past her prime, but even in her early 50s, she looked lovely and she was charming and she was a wonderful light actress who had done many films and shows with Noel Coward. And the thing that has to be kept in mind, though, is that she was not a great singer. She had a decent voice, a small voice. It used to be larger. I mean, she was capable of being Liza Elliott in A Lady in the Dark in 1941, and that's a show, you know, that has song. That's not an easy song to sing, but that was 1941. And now we're in 1951, and she doesn't sing so well, and she has a small range, but she's got charm. And Rodgers and Hammerstein felt that this could be a winner. They needed to find somebody to play the king, and on the suggestion of Mary Martin, who co-starred with Yul Brynner in a show in 1946 called Lute Song, they hired Yul Brynner. Yul Brynner was born in 1920. He was a young guy still. He had played the guitar and accompanied himself as a gypsy folk singer in Paris. He had a strong but brittle voice, anything but lyrical. And it's quite interesting that the show might have originally been called Anna and the King of Siam, But ironically, and I don't know if it had any relationship, but once Ewell Brynner became part of it, the title was most certainly The King and I. He ruled that show. He spent his lifetime on that show. As a matter of fact, the recording we're going to talk about later on, which was made in 1977, which I had the great good fortune to produce, was Ewell Brynner's final recorded statement of the show. And of course, he was a good deal older and his voice was lower, but he still gave a fantastic performance. Now, here's the thing. When the show was written, the record business was quite different than when this revival cast came about on stage in New York. When the show was written, recordings were made on 10-inch shellac records, 78 RPM, and they played about 3 minutes a side. Well, that was therefore the average length of a popular song. That was the length of the songs that got played on my hit parade, and that became hits. I mean, so many Broadway shows had hit songs. But in the case of a show like The King and I, it was less likely that the more beautiful romantic songs were going to be sung by the two leads, neither one of which had a great voice, but they certainly had individual unique personalities. So in The King and I, there's a secondary cast. And that secondary cast, which is a slave girl and the man she's in love with, they are, in fact, tenor and soprano, and they have beautiful voices. And they're the ones who are going to carry the ballads in the song, in the show. They're the ones who will provide the material that, in fact, may wind up on your hit parade. But what I'm trying to say is this. When you get to the era of the long-playing record, which ran about 25 minutes a side, which means it ran for about 50 minutes, you were no longer constricted to just playing the songs. So making what's called an original cast album of a Broadway show no longer necessarily had to be the trimming of the material so that it would be hit parade 3 minute length. It meant that you had the option as the producer of the recordings, which I was, of doing things that run much longer, of doing things that in a show as serious as The King and I, for example, you could express the context of a song so that when Anna, for example, sings at the beginning of the show, I whistle a happy tune, it's not just that it's a pretty tune, you know. But it has a meaning. It has a reason for being there. Now, one reason is Rodgers and Hammerstein were giving the star of the show the first song. That makes a lot of sense. But as I said, the star of this show was in her 50s, her voice was going, and they knew damn well that in writing a song for her, they had to keep the range, the lowest note to the highest note, fairly narrow, and they had to give her plenty of time to take breaths. So just listen to the song as I pull it apart a little bit. Breath. 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 Now this whole thing took place in the span of an octave. That's so a song like this could take advantage of all Gertrude Lawrence's charm without in any way taxing her breath control or her vocal strength. Now, what happened in 1977 when this revival was produced is that they had a fantastically gifted, with a lovely voice, woman, Constance Towers, to play the role that was originally Gertrude Lawrence. Constance Towers plays Anna, and she was a fabulous performer, and she, in connection with Ewell Brynner, made a terrific starring couple. This show had a terrific cast, beautifully directed, and when we decided to make a recording, we even expanded the orchestra so that the whole thing became even bigger and richer. Now, what happened was the revival was very successful, and the Rodgers and Hammerstein office contacted me. I was at RCA at the time, and they asked me if I would produce a new recording of The King and I. And I was thrilled at the opportunity. First of all, it meant I'd be working once again with Dick Rodgers, and we had a really nice working relationship. And I liked him tremendously. I think he liked me. It also meant that I had the opportunity to make the kind of King and I recording that I felt it ought to have. I didn't think the songs should be 3 minutes long. I thought that the songs should now be contextual, that you would know from listening to the recording, without sets, without lights, without costumes, you would have some idea of where the plot was, of what the character was doing, of what the emotions were, of what the conflicts were, so that the songs were not merely entertainment. God knows they were great entertainment, but they, in addition to that, they told you the story, they gave you the context, they gave the performers the opportunity to express themselves, not only musically, but dramatically. So let's go now to the top of The King and I, which, as I said, the first song is charming, I Whistle a Happy Tune. But why did Anna sing it? Well, she sang it because when she and her young son, Louis, and their boat pulled up near the shores of Siam, the first thing they saw were these almost naked men rowing a barge. And the barge was being rowed out to the ship where Anna and her young son were waiting to disembark. Now, these guys, first of all, you're going to hear the orchestra playing quasi, I guess, Oriental music. So you get the feeling that you really are, you know, in a very dramatic, unusual situation. And then you hear these men going, these are semi-naked men, and they are rowing the barge to pick up Anna and Louis. And the prime minister of Siam is there to welcome them as well. Well, it's obviously a fairly frightening experience. This is for Anna and Louis, I think, their first barge, their first being rowed to by naked men, and their first look at Siam. So it's not surprising that they would be apprehensive. In fact, they might even be fearful. So in a case like that, Louis asked his mother, you know, aren't you ever afraid? And she said, well, I suppose sometimes, but here's what I do about it. And then she sings. Okay, you don't want to hear me. You want to hear Constance Towers sing I Whistle a Happy Tune, preceded by the sounds of Siam and the slaves rowing the barge. Here goes.
Strike a careless pose and whistle a happy tune. and no one ever knows, I'm afraid. The result of this deception is very strange to tell, for when I fool the people I fear, I fool myself as well. I whistle a happy tune, and every single time the happiness in the tune convinces me that I'm not afraid. Make believe you're brave, and the trick will take you far. You may be as brave as you make believe you are. You may be as brave as you make believe you are.
I think that's a very good idea, Mother. A very good idea.
Well, it is a good idea, isn't it?
I don't think I shall ever be afraid again.
Good.
The result of this deception is very strange to tell, for when I fool the people I fear, I fool myself as well. I whistle a happy tune, and every single time
the happiness in the tune convinces me that I'm not afraid.
Make believe you're brave, and the trick will take you far. You may be as brave as you make believe you are. You may be as brave as you make believe you are.
Shortly after Anna arrives, she meets an emissary from Burma who has brought with him a slave girl who is going to be given to the king as a present. Her name is Tup Tim. His name is Lun Ta. They're young, they're very, very good looking, and we learn that they are indeed very much in love, and she's about to be given off to the king, which is not a very pleasant situation for either one of them. They can't avoid the situation, but as you can probably guess, it won't be very long before they will have songs which are passionate and lyrical and romantic, which will express their unrequited love. In the meantime, Tup Tim has learned that the king is pleased with her. Well, that doesn't register very well with her. She doesn't like that too much. She says, ironically, you know, he is pleased with me, the king is pleased. And then she sings a song called My Lord and Master, which is a beautiful song and has an additional quality that I would like to describe. There are five notes that the black keys represent. There are seven notes that the white keys represent. Now, if a composer chooses just to use, which we call the pentatonic scale, he or she is limiting himself or herself in terms of the range of the melody, but it creates a rather exotic feel to the material. So when you hear Tup Tim sing My Lord and Master, it's on a very limited number of notes. It's basically on five notes. That's three of them. There's the fourth one, the fifth one, and then we return. These are the five notes that form the entire, at least a bulk of the piece. I want you to hear this as it's sung very beautifully by June Angela.
The king is pleased. He is pleased with me, my lord and master. pleased with me. What does he
takes a moment before Anna has great sympathy for Lunta and Tuptim, and as she tells them, she knows what it's like to be in love. She was in love once, she's now a widow, and she sings a song to them, Hello Young Lovers, which is very, very beautiful. And again, the extraordinarily clever Richard Rodgers has written it for a woman with limited range and limited breath, which of course does not apply to Constance Towers, but it applied to Gertrude Lawrence. Therefore, the melody, if you just break the song apart a bit, couldn't be much simpler than that. Sing, and you're going to hear it sung beautifully now by Constance Towers.
When I think of Tom, I think about a night when the earth smelled of summer and the sky was streaked with white and the soft mist of England was sleeping on a hill. I remember this and I always will. There are new lovers now on the same silent hill, looking on the same blue sea. And I know Tom and I are a part of them all, and they're all a part of Tom.
plot of King and I, a certain amount of acrimony gets going because the king had promised Anna a house of her own, and at least at present he's reneging on his promise. So she's not terribly happy. She feels she's not getting what she wanted. The king is a most brilliant man and a self-educated man with a great interest in being part of the international community where his small country will play an important part in this great big world. He has a lot of wives, and each of his wives have a lot of children. It's a big family, and the reason Anna has been brought to Siam by the king is because she is supposed to be teaching both the children and the children's mothers. There are a lot of mothers, there are a lot more children, and they're about to be introduced to Anna Lee and Owens. She will sit there while these children come in, either too young to walk because they're held in their mother's arms, or they're toddlers, or they're preteens, or they're teens, or they are the crown prince, whose name is Chula Longhorn, and who is a teenager, and whose mother is in fact the king's first wife. Chief wife, and she plays, her name is Lady Tiang, and she plays a very important role in this show. She's also a performer with a wonderful voice, as you will hear, and so she also can carry the ballads, as can Lunta and Tuptim, far better in a way than can Anna or the king. Now, Rodgers was a really gifted composer and an original one. He wrote a march, and this march is for the entrance of the children. This is the children of the King of Siam. Now, he wrote it in the key of F, which would normally have a scale like, but Rodgers wrote it for a rather different F scale. He wrote, strange, exotic. And why did he do it? Because he was creating a whole mood. It's a beautiful little piece. I will play you some of it. Thank you. I play this, instead of playing it for you from the recording, it's just simply that I love to play it. I just love the piece. Okay, you're now going past the children all meeting Mrs. Anna, and we're going to hear from the king himself. He's now about to have his first solo. It's called A Puzzlement. It's a soliloquy. The king is basically talking to himself. He begins to doubt whether he is as universally wise as he's always thought he was, or as everybody else thinks him to be. He wonders if there's much that he should know. He wonders if really the best way to live is to have concubines and wives, and to be wary of international collaborations with other governments, because you can't know if necessarily if you can trust them. But even though he is puzzled by all this, and the song is called A Puzzlement, he believes that in the end, he can prevail. And so here we are, Yul Brynner singing A Puzzlement.
When I was a boy, world was better spot. What was so, what was not, now I'm a man, world have changed a lot. Something's nearly so, others nearly not. There are times I almost think I am not sure of what I absolutely know. Very often find confusion in conclusion I concluded long ago. In my head are many facts that as a student I have studied to procure. In my head are many facts of which I wish I was more certain. I was sure. Is a puzzlement. What to tell a growing son? What, for instance, shall I say to him of women? Shall I educate him on the ancient lines? Shall I tell the boy as far as he's able to respect his wives and love his concubines? Shall I tell him every one is like the other, and the better one of two is really neither? If I tell him this, I think he won't believe it. And I nearly think I don't believe it either. When my father was a king, he was a king who knew exactly what he knew. And his brain was not a thing forever swinging to and fro and fro and to. Shall I then be like my father and be willfully unmovable and strong? Or is better to be right, or am I right when I believe I may be wrong? Shall I join with other nations in alliance? If allies are weak, am I not best alone? If allies are strong with power to protect me, might they not protect me out of all I own? Is a danger to be trusting one another? One will seldom want to do what other wishes. But unless someday somebody trusts somebody, there'll be nothing left on earth excepting fishes. There are times I almost think nobody's sure of what he absolutely knows. Everybody find confusion in conclusion he concluded long ago. And it puzzled me to learn that though a man may be in doubt of what he knows, very quickly will he fight, he'll fight to prove that what he does not no is so. Oh, sometimes I think that people going mad apart. Sometimes I think that people not so bad, but no matter what I think, I must go on living life. As leader of my kingdom, I must go forth. Be father to my children and husband to each wife, etc., etc., and so forth. If my Lord in heaven would have shown the way, every day I try to live another day. If my Lord in heaven would have shown the way, every day I do my best for one more day. But ease a puzzlement.
Okay, now it's Anna's turn again. She is teaching these children. They bond instantly. She loves them. They love her. And she makes sure that they realize that she feels she is being taught by them just as they are being taught by her. Now again, the innermost secrets of how compositions can sometimes be made. It's called Getting to Know You, and it's a charming song. It has a particular place in the show. It's important in the plot because this is the bonding of these children with Anna Lee and Owens. But again, the very, very clever and economical Dick Rodgers. Lovely and simple and sincere, and here's Constance Towers. Beautiful rendition.
It's a very ancient saying, but a true and honest thought, that if you become a teacher, by your pupils you will be taught. As a teacher I've been learning, you'll forgive me if I boast, but I've now become an expert on the subject I like most. Getting to know you. Getting to know you. Getting to know all about you. Getting to like you. Getting to hope you like me. Getting to know you, putting it my way, but nicely. You are precisely my cup of tea. Getting to know you, getting to feel free and easy. When I am with you, getting to know. You noticed suddenly I'm bright and breezy because of all the beautiful and new things I'm learning about you day by day.
Getting to know. Like you.
as I was working out how and what I wanted to record from this show, one thing became very clear to me, which was that Yul Brynner was, in my opinion, seriously shortchanged on the original cast album, because very significant things that he did in the show were not recorded, because they were not 3-minute pop songs, so they never made it to the original cast album. He has a soliloquy of his own coming up again. He talks to himself a lot. This one is called So Big a World. It's not really sung, it's spoken. But the point of the number, as you will hear, is his reaffirmation of his own extraordinary abilities. Let me say this. I knew that I wanted to get every drop out of Yul Brynner for this recording, so it would be significantly different from the first one. And when I first met him, almost the first thing I said to him was, you know, I really want to get virtually everything you do musically on this album. And I have a feeling that all I really did was beat him to the punch. I think he was about to say to me, you know, now look, Tom, I hope you record a lot more of me than got recorded the first time. So perhaps I preempted him on that, but one thing is for sure, we got along very well. He was so pleased that these many years later, he was getting the chance to really interpret the role of the king on a recording. No sets, no lights, no costumes. Nevertheless, the opportunity to really present to the listening public a very well-rounded and thoughtful theatrical performance. So you're going to hear So Big a World, and you're going to see how once again, after he has a troublesome, perhaps lack of confidence, by the time this little number is over, he's back on track. Nothing's going to stop him.
So big a world. Siam, very small. England, very small. All people, very small. No man big enough for to be alone. No man big enough. King? King different. King need no one. Nobody at all. I think.
Now, as I said earlier, one of the points of a show where the two leads are not necessarily the world's best vocalists is that there have to be other people in the show to carry the more romantic numbers. And as I also said to you, in this particular case, it's Tuptim and Lunta. They are young, they are in love, it's an unrequited love, and it's never going to be requited, and they have beautiful voices. So they sing a song called We Kiss in a Shadow. It became very, very popular. It's a very unusual song because part of the song, a very important part of the song, is not sung at all. It's only played in the orchestra. You're going to hear. And then they're going to sing. Then you're going to hear the orchestra again. Then they'll sing. Orchestra again. Listen to this beautiful duet.
and believe what you see.
Okay, now we're back into a less lyrical world because Anna is very, very annoyed, very, very ticked off. She's not getting the house she wanted. The king undermines her many, many times, embarrasses her publicly, and she's not so sure she wants to stay in Siam. She's just about getting ready to leave. And so she has this long number where she's alone in her room musing on what's been going on and trying to make a decision whether to stay or to go. And of course, as you might have expected, her relationship with these children is so strong that it has more to keep her there than anything else. This is a wonderful dramatic tour de force by Constance Towers, and we're going to play all of it right now.
Your servant, indeed, I'm not your servant, although you give me less than servant's pay. I'm a free and independent employee. Because I'm a woman, you think like every woman, I have to be a slave or concubine. You conceited, self-indulgent, libertine. How I wish I'd called him that. Right to his face, libertine. And while we're on the subject, sire, there are certain goings-on around this place that I wish to tell you I do not admire. I do not like polygamy or even moderate bigamy. I realize that in your eyes that clearly makes a prig of me, but I am from a civilized land called Wales.
men like you are kept in county jails.
In your pursuit of pleasure, you have mistresses who treasure you. They have no ken of other men beside whom they can measure you. A flock of sheep and you are the only ram. No wonder you're the wonder of Siam. Really rather glad I didn't say that. Not with the women right there. And the children. The children, the children. I'll not forget the children. No matter where I go, I'll always see those little faces looking up at me. First, when I started to teach, they were shy and remained out of reach. But lately I've thought one or two have been caught by a word I have said or a sentence I've read. And I've heard an occasional question that implied and released a suggestion that the work I was trying to do was beginning to show with a few. That prince, Chulalongkorn, is very like his father. He's stubborn, but inquisitive and smart. I must leave this place before they break my heart. I must leave this place before they break my heart. Oh, gracious! Why, I had no idea it was so late. Tell you what I think of you, you're spoilt. You're a conscientious worker, but you're spoilt. Giving credit where it's due, there is much I like in you, but it's also very true that you're spoilt. Everybody's always bowing to the king. Everybody has to grovel to the king. By your Buddha you are blessed, by your ladies you're caressed, but the one who loves you best is the king. All that bowing and kowtowing to remind you of your royalty, I find a most disgusting exhibition. I wouldn't ask a Siamese cat to demonstrate his loyalty by taking this ridiculous position. How would you like it if you were a man playing the part of a toad, crawling around on your elbows and knees, eating the dust of the road? Toads! Toads! All of your people are toads! Yes, Your Majesty, no, Your Majesty, tell us how low to go, Your Majesty. Make some more decrees, Your Majesty. Don't let us up off our knees, Your Majesty. Give us a kick if it please, Your Majesty. Give us a kick if you would, Your Majesty. Oh! Oh, that was good, Your Majesty!
The king's head wife, Lady Tiang, sung by Hye-Young Choi. She's a very wise woman. She's his first wife. She knows that he is a fallible man, but she also knows that his dreams, even if they won't come true, are things that he believes in and that he really wants to make himself and his kingdom a better place. And she sings this song to Mrs. Anna, who, as you heard in the prior number, was just about ready to pack her bags. But she says, no, you know, there's a whole other side to this guy, and you have to pay attention. He doesn't always say what you want him to say, but every once in a while he'll say something that's wonderful. He may do things that you consider thoughtless and that make you worry, but then every once in a while he'll do something wonderful. It's an unusual song in another way, because it's a tune that begins on the second beat of each bar. I'll give you an example. One. One. One, two. And Lehman Engel, that wonderful conductor and musical scholar and teacher, said to me that he always thought that that first beat was a sigh, so that the song really was like, sigh, he will not always say, sigh, what you would have him say, sigh. Hear it as it was sung in this revival by Lady Tiang. Okay, it's time for the king to have another number which was left out of the original cast album back in 1951. It's a very short number. It's called Song of the King. He's actually singing it to Mrs. Anna, who is in the song itself. It's, my God, it's almost a duet. Except the king is hardly singing at all. He's mostly talking, whereas she does sing a phrase. The basis of the song is a justification of polygamy, which is that a bee can go from blossom to blossom. A king can go from woman to woman. But a blossom can never go from bee to bee to bee. The woman can never go to more than one man. In Brynner's hands, it's charming. Here it is.
A woman is a female who is human. Designed for pleasing man, the human male. A human male is pleased by many women, and all the rest you hear is fairy tale.
Then tell me how the fairy tale began, sir. You cannot call it just a poet's trick. Explain to me why many men are faithful and true to one wife only.
They are sick. A girl must be like a blossom, with honey for just one man. A man must live like honeybee and gather all he can. To fly from blossom to blossom, a honeybee must be free. But blossom must not ever fly from bee to bee to bee.
We're getting near the end of the show. The next number, which is called Shall We Dance, is a polka. And it is, in fact, a duet between Anna and the king. It is, in fact, what you would call the 11 o'clock number. It's near the end of the show, and it really revs everybody up, because this is a song where, despite their differences and their heritages and everything else that pulls them apart, there is definitely a physical magnetic attraction between Anna and the king, and it gets expressed as they dance this number. I have recorded it completely so that what you hear is the king challenging Mrs. Anna to dance with him, where they actually hold each other and where she gives him lessons on how to polka. So it brings out a lot of charm in the two of them. It also brings out the animal magnetism in the two of them. Now, if your knowledge of The King and I were based on the original recording, you would think that the show ended there, which it does not, by the way. But in the meantime, please listen to Yul Brynner and Constance Towers do Shall We Dance?
We've just been introduced. I do not know you well. But when the music started, something drew me to your side. So many men and girls are in each other's arms. It made me think we might be similarly occupied.
Shall we dance? Shall we dance? stop. You dance pretty. Go on, go on, go on, go on.
Oh, no, Your Majesty, I didn't realize that... Oh, you see, in my country, a woman would never dance while a man was looking on.
But you will dance with a strange man, holding hands, etc.
Well, not always a strange man. Sometimes a very good friend.
Good. Then we'll dance together. You show me. Teach, teach, teach.
Well, it's really very simple. The polka goes 1, 2, 3, and 1, 2, 3, and 1, 2, 3, and 1. Shall we dance?
1, 2, 3, and...
On a bright cloud of music shall we fly?
1, 2, 3, and...
Shall we dance?
1, 2, 3, and...
Shall we then say goodnight and mean goodbye?
1, 2, 3, and... Oh, perchance, when the last little star has left the sky,
shall we still be together with our arms around each other? And shall you be my new
romance?
On the clear understanding that this kind of thing can happen,
shall we dance?
Shall we dance?
Shall we dance?
And 1, 2, 3, and 1, 2, 3, and 1, 2, 3, and 1, 2.
Not good at all. Why no? I forget. And.
Oh. And 1, 2, 3, and 1, 2, 3, and 1, 2, 3, and splendid, Your Majesty.
Splendid, splendid.
Yes.
You throw me off count. And 1, 2, 3,
and 1, 2, 3,
and 1, 2, 3,
and 1, 2, 3.
But it's not right.
Oh, yes, it is. You're doing beautifully.
Not the way I see Europeans dancing tonight.
Well, yes, it was. It was exactly like this.
We're not holding two hands like this.
Oh. Oh, well, no. No, as a matter of fact.
Was a... like this. No? Come.
Story about recording this. As you heard, there's an instrumental section which closes the number, which is very alive, very vital, and you imagine the two of them dancing together with great joy. But Milton Rosenstock, the wonderful conductor of this show, took this instrumental at a tempo much faster than Dick Rodgers really wanted. And Rodgers was very annoyed. He was in the control room with me. Milton was conducting take one. The polka was going too fast and Rodgers was getting aggravated. Now, Rodgers had a serious physical problem, which was he had had a laryngectomy, which made it very difficult for him to talk. He was only able to talk by gulping air and getting out maybe a half a dozen words before he would gulp air and say more. So when the number was over, and Rodgers was, as I said, he was annoyed, he pushed the button on the talkback in the control room so that he could talk to Milton, who was in the actual studio with the orchestra. And Rodgers could only get a few words out at a time, and that was frustrating him. And he was getting more and more frustrated, and he was getting more and more aggravated as he was trying to make his point. Milton understood immediately. He said, "Dick, you want it slower, we'll do it slower." And so the take that you just heard is the one that Richard Rodgers approved of, because Milton Rosenstock gave it to Rodgers at exactly the tempo that Rodgers wanted. Now, as I said, the original cast recording ended here, but the show doesn't end here. The show goes on to what may be its most important moment, which is the death of the king. And this was not a musical number, but I felt very strongly that it had to be preserved. And here's the way it worked. Anna and her son are on the ship leaving Siam. She's had enough. The king is sick. They didn't get along very well, as you know. And she's on the boat, ready to sail back to England or to Wales. And an emissary of the king delivers a letter to Anna on the boat. Now, while she's reading the letter, I bring in an instrumental version, which I had Milton Rosenstock construct, of Something Wonderful. And we timed it out so that this entire instrumental would be exactly the length of the dialogue that we included. And the dialogue goes thusly. Anna starts to read the letter that the king has written to her on the boat, a letter that is both sad and a little bit self-defensive. Now, I had to get Anna off of that boat somehow and back into the king's chamber, because that's where she's going to be. But I had to find a very expeditious way to get her there. So as she was reading the letter that the king wrote to her, I crossfaded by having Anna fade down as the king fades up, as he continues reading the letter that he wrote to her. By the time he finishes the letter, she's on board. And as he is dying, she once again puts her head lower than his and dutifully listens as he brings forth his final wishes. Now, what happens after that is that his son, Chula Longhorn, who was about to be crowned the next king of Siam, has been asked by his father, what will you do if you are king? And Chula Longhorn has a lot of things to say, among them, no more bowing and scraping like toads. And the king asks him, what things would you like to do? And Chula Longhorn says, well, you know, I like fireworks. It's charming, and it's very, very sad. And I had to figure out a way to end this. Chula Longhorn couldn't talk forever, but he's going through this litany of things that he will do and will not do when he is the king of Siam. And the way I handled it was that as he went along, sonically, I kept moving him further and further back, while at the same time, I kept making the orchestra come up louder and louder. So the orchestra will, in fact, drown out Chula Longhorn, but you imagine that he's going to keep on talking. And I think somehow or other, you get the feeling that we are going into the future that Chula Longhorn is wishing. I believe that ending it with this music and with him being pushed back, we get a sense that life will go on. And I'll make a confession to you. When I made the original cast album of 1776, I faced a very similar problem, because the clerk of the court reads the names of each of the 13 colonies. And as he reads them, the representative of each colony comes up to the desk and signs the Declaration of Independence. So it's a stage full of people, but it's not a recording full of people. The only thing you hear on the recording is the clerk of the court and the sound of the Liberty Bell. And again, I had to figure out how to end this dramatically. It just can't be with a reading. So the same thing is with Chula Longhorn. As the clerk of the court got nearer the end of naming each representative of the 13 colonies, I pulled back his sound. I made him recede into some unknown distance, and at the same time, the orchestra that was playing under him, I had them play louder and louder so that they would in fact overwhelm him. And it's the same sort of thing, again, difficult to explain, but with the orchestra overwhelming what was happening in the present, it somehow, to me at least, gave the feeling that what had just happened is something that was going to be ongoing in the future. I hope it makes its point. I hope you enjoy this finale. It's kind of my pride and joy. I'm so pleased with the way Constance and Yul Brynner and the young Chula Longhorn performed it, and it ends this recording. And by the way, it ends my working with Richard Rodgers. This was 1977. He died 2 years later. I never saw him again after this recording, and we had worked together before. We had worked together when I produced the cast album of Rex and the cast album of 2x2. And I liked him enormously, and I miss him. But he was a giant of musical theater. He was brilliant. He was intuitive. He was definitely a man of the theater. Yes, he was a songwriter, but more than that, he was a very, very gifted composer. And I will cherish my memories of my experiences of getting to know him and working with him. I want to thank you for listening. Once again, I've tried to combine a little history with a little music, and I hope the balance is such that you are informed and entertained. Thank you for being here. Good night.
While I am lying here, I think perhaps I die. This heart, which you say I do not have, is a matter of concern. It occurs to me that there shall be nothing wrong but men shall die. For all that shall matter about man is that he shall have tried his utmost best. You have spoken truth to me always, and for this I have often lost my temper on you. But I do not wish to die without saying this gratitude, etc. I think it very strange that a woman shall have been
most earnest help of all. But Mrs. Arna, you must remember that you have been a very difficult woman, and much more difficult than generality. Many months I do not see you, Mrs. Arna. And now I die.
No, Your Majesty.
This is not scientific. I know if I die or leaving Siam? When?
Very soon. In fact, I can only stay a very few minutes.
And you are glad of this? People of Siam, royal children, etc., are not glad. And all are in great affliction of your departure.
I shall miss them.
You shall miss them. But you shall be leaving. I too am leaving. But I am not walking onto a boat with my own feet. my own free will. I am just leaving. Why is your head higher than mine? Here. Here's something belonging to you. Put it on. Put it on. It is your ring. Please, wear it always. Tu l'as encore. Rise. Mrs. Anna, please, take notes. You take notes from next king. Well, suppose you are king. Is there nothing you would do?
I would make proclamations.
Yes, yes.
First, I would proclaim for coming New Year fireworks. Also, boat races.
Boat races? Why boat races with New Year celebration?
I like boat races. And Father, I would make second proclamation.
Yes, what is second proclamation? Go ahead, make it, make it.
Regarding custom of bowing to king in fashion of lowly toad, I do not believe it to be good thing, causing embarrassing fatigue of body, degrading experience for soul, etc., etc., etc. This is bad thing. I believe. You are angry with me, my father?
Oh, why do you ask question? If you are king, you are king. You do not ask question of sick man. No, of woman. This is Anna, this proclamation. Against bowing to king. I believe to be your fault.
I hope so, Your Majesty. I do hope so.
Up! Rise up!
Up, up, up. Like soldiers in two lines. It has been said, there shall be no more bowing. Showing respect for king. It has been said by one who has been trained for royal government.
No bowing like toad. No crouching. No crawling. This does not mean, however, that you do not show respect for king.